Okay, once again, very good morning to all. In the last class, I hope we have discussed about a few of these topics, cell splitting, cell sectorization, and then we have seen some mathematical derivations, okay, which are basically relating this frequency reuse factor and the cluster size. Okay, and then I hope we have started the discussion on this propagation of this in free space. And then I hope you have stopped there. Let us continue from that particular point. Okay. And then in today's class, we'll try to look at the interference portion, where the two types of interference, one is adjacent channel and co-channel interference. And we'll try to derive some mathematical expression for this co-channel interference. And then we'll try to solve some problem. And after that, we'll try to look up the topic of trunking and grade of service. This grade of service basically known as a probability of blocking a particular call. And then on top of that, we'll try to solve some problems. Okay, this particular problem in trunking and grade of service will cover almost all the topics that we have seen so far. So, okay, let's look into it. So this, I hope we have already seen cell splitting, then sectorization, interference, okay, and then this relation between frequency reuse factor and cluster size, and the mathematical derivation that we have seen, this d, which is equal to d square equal to this capital D is co-channel distance and small d is adjacent cell distance, and n is I square plus j square plus I into j, and this is the basic relation that you have, d square by r square equal to 3 into I square plus j square into I, okay, plus I into j. And then we have derived, okay, in the last class, this particular expression d by r, which is what we call it as frequency reuse factor, which is equal to square root of 3 into n. Okay, that means you can find out this either in terms of if d and r are given or if a cluster size is given. Okay, so these mathematical formulas will use it in solving the problems. Okay. And this I hope we have seen. Okay, the cluster size is depends upon I and j, where I and j are integers. Okay, this I hope we have derived it from these things itself. Okay, and then we have started up with this propagation in free space. Let me quickly go through from this particular point onwards. Okay, what we are trying to establish is if I'm trying to transmit this signal with a power pt. Okay, at a particular distance d, what is the, if I'm placing a mobile handset over here, what is the amount of power that is received by this mobile handset? Okay, for this, we are trying to derive a mathematical relation, and in which we are assuming that this is a free space. Okay, so that means a medium is basically a lossless medium that we are trying to consider. Okay, this is an ideal case, need not be practical. In a practical case, okay, we'll try to slightly change this, the multipath component, whatever that we are having it. Okay, that we'll try to see it in subsequent classes. Okay, so we have started up with this basic thing, and we said we are trying to transmit with a power PT, and this is the sphere that is surrounded by this particular base station, and then we said the radius of this particular sphere is R, so the surface area of this particular sphere is 4 pi r square, the total surface area of that. And then we said the medium is free space. Okay. And what we are trying to find out is I'm trying to find at a location y. Basically, I'm assuming that this is 1, okay, square meter, basically the area of this 1 meter square, okay, or unit area I'm trying to consider. So we know that, okay, the power intensity we are trying to find it out. Okay, so power intensity is basically the power coming out per unit area. We know that, okay, PT is the total transmission power and it is equally radiating in all the directions. And we know that the medium is free space, hence there is no losses. So the total power would be coming out of this particular sphere with an area of 4 pi r square. Now, what we are trying to find out it is we are trying to find out, okay, per this 1 meter square or per unit area, how much amount of power that is coming out. Okay, that is equal to what power intensity, that is equal to what total power that is coming out of this area divided by 4 pi r square is going to give you power that is coming out of this particular unit area. And then on top of that, what we are saying it is, here I am trying to put up a mobile handset which is having a receiving antenna, okay? And then what this receiving antenna will do, it is whatever is coming out of this particular area, a portion of that will be captured by the receiving antenna, okay? Not everything will be captured, but a portion. That depends upon the aperture area of your receiving antenna, whatever the receiver antenna that I'm trying to put it. So in terms of that aperture area, we are trying to find out the amount of received power. So received power is equal to what? The power intensity that is coming out completely, and out of that, what fraction that is what is being received by the receiving antenna. So that is equal to what? Received power equal to S into A, where A is the effective aperture area of this particular mobile receiving antenna. Okay, this we have seen it in the last class. Received power equal to S, I'm substituting PT by 4 pi r square into A. Now we wanted to establish this complete relation PR. Now we have got received power of this, what are the mobile antenna that I'm putting, in terms of transmission power and then the distance that we are having it. Okay, now we wanted to further add few more components to this particular thing. Okay, further, if the case that we have considered is, it is a directional and omnidirectional antenna which radiates equally in all the direction. Okay, in subsequent slides we have seen for a directional case what is going to happen. In omnidirectional case, we said that okay, the total power PT is the total power that is radiating out of this. So the power intensity at this particular point is what? PT by 4 pi r square. This is what we have seen. Now the difference between this and the directional antenna is, now this antenna is radiating only in this direction, not all. So the effective area that it is covering would be less. Okay, keeping all other parameters same. So this is what the area that is covered by this particular antenna. So now if I'm trying to put up a mobile handset here, and then I'm trying to find out what is the power received, or basically finding out the power intensity at this particular point. Power intensity is equal to what? The total power that is coming out of this area divided by PT divided by the area covered by this. And when I'm comparing this and this, you can see that this area is approximately 1/3 of this particular area. That's what I have considered. Hence I'm writing directional antenna, the power intensity is equal to what? Same PT, but this 4 pi r square, I'm writing it as 1/3. So as in the denominator I have 1/3, this 3 factor comes up, and you can see that in terms of this power intensity of a directional antenna, in terms of omnidirectional antenna, is giving us a factor of 3 here. Okay, so this particular factor we call it as gain of the transmitting antenna. This is gain of the transmitting antenna. More general mathematical expression if I'm writing. So directivity, or for a directional antenna, okay, so in terms of omnidirectional antenna, the power intensity is multiplied by the gain of the transmitting antenna. Okay, and similarly power received is equal to what? For directional, gain of the transmitting antenna, because this is basically received power equal to S into A. Okay, and S is basically GT into this. So hence this multiplied by A would be the received power for a directional case. This we have seen it in the last class. So another factor that is coming into picture here is gain of the transmitting antenna. So the power received is equal to what? This was basically, we have started up with S into A. S is the power intensity for omnidirectional antenna, and the A is effective aperture area of your receiving antenna. So GT is because of the directionality of that particular antenna. Okay, and then what we are trying to do is, we are trying to establish some relation, effective isotropic radiated power. This PT into GT put together, we call it as effective isotropic radiated power. So the power that is being radiated effectively. And then, okay, with this antenna's concept, okay, the effective aperture area is, and the gain of the antenna is directly proportional. And with this mathematical relation, GR, which is equal to 4 pi A by lambda square with respect to a particular antenna, then A, I can write it as GR into lambda square by 4 pi. So this, if I'm substituting here, GR into lambda square by 4 pi, then what you get it is received power is equal to what? PT, GT, GR divided by this particular quantity. If I'm trying to look at this complete expression clearly, received power is equal to what? The transmission power multiplied by whatever the gain of the transmitting antenna with which I'm trying to transmit, multiplied by, at the receiver side you have another antenna, so what is the gain of that particular receiving antenna, divided by, I have a this particular in the denominator, this is what we call it as path loss. Okay, that is the what the received power that I have at a distance r. So path loss component that I'm trying to write it, and these things for convenience sake we'll try to put everything in terms of dB. So when I'm trying to put everything in terms of dB, you'll get PT in terms of dB plus GT plus GR minus this L is nothing but this path loss I'm calling. Okay, so ultimately what we are trying to get from this particular expression is received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance, and this is the case when we are trying to consider a free space. Received power is inversely proportional to square of the distance. This is an ideal case where we are assuming that the medium is free space. Okay, keeping this in the mind, we'll try to extend this for a cellular case. Exact mathematical derivation we'll try to see it in subsequent classes, but as of now, in a cellular case, what is the difference? Okay, so not only you have a line of sight component, but you have this multiple component that will be arriving at the receiver. Okay, now because of this particular medium, okay, previous derivation whatever that we have done, this medium was free space. That means, okay, there was no obstructions, there was no losses because of this particular medium. That is the reason why we are getting received power is inversely proportional to square of this particular distance. But now what we are trying to say is, in more practical case, not only you have this man-made structures, okay, because of these things you have this multipath propagation and all, so no longer the medium is a free space or an isotropic medium. So in such a cases, received power would not be inversely proportional to square of the distance whatever that we have, but rather than that you can see that received power depends upon, okay, inversely proportional to r power n. I'm trying to consider where n is basically, I'm assuming that it is a path loss component, because basically there is a path loss component. This, okay, this would be different in a different scenarios. Suppose if I'm taking n equal to 2, which is what we call it as free space, n would be changing, okay, depending upon the medium that you are having it. Probably, okay, if you are going in an open ground, the amount of obstructions that you have would be less. Suppose if you are sitting inside a building, the amount of obstructions would be different. Their path loss would be different, hence the received power accordingly would also be different. Because if I'm sitting in a building, then probably the signal has to penetrate through the walls of the building, okay, and then probably floors of that particular building, and then walls of the building, and if you have, okay, glass materials kind of thing, then it has to penetrate through all those things, and by the time it reaches your receiver, the signal power received would be low. So these all should reflect in this component, received power PR. So hence received power is inversely proportional to, okay, r power n. That is the main thing that we will try to consider. The derivation that we have done it for free space, and we have assumed that for free space n equal to 2, that's what we have got it. But in general you will get received power is directly proportional to, okay, 1 by r power n, where n is, we call it as path loss component. Okay, in the second chapter we are trying, we are completely dedicating with these path loss models and all. So there we'll try to see, we'll try to have a derivation where we'll try to consider a line of sight component and one reflected wave. Only for these two we'll try to derive, and we'll try to see that you'll get r power 4 when I have only two components. So subsequently we'll try to have that mathematical derivations, but as of now we are assuming that, okay, received power is inversely proportional to r power n. This is the important thing that we have to understand in deriving the subsequent mathematical expressions. So keeping all those things aside, I'm just concluding about this received power. Received power is inversely proportional to distance, and how it is, okay, dependent, because received power is inversely proportional to r power n. If the medium is free space, then we consider n equal to 2. If the medium is open ground or kind of thing, then n would be something different. And if I have man-made buildings and all, n would be something different. Generally, n value would be from 2 to 6 or 2 to 6 to, or probably up to 7 you have, depending upon the context we have to consider. Few examples that I have considered in the environment and the path loss component that will be taken. So if it is free space, then we'll try to consider n equal to 2. That is what we have derived in the previous slide. An urban area where cellular radio that we are trying to consider, in an urban area, we'll try to consider from 2.7 to 5. Okay, in buildings where you have line of sight component, then you may consider 1.6 to 1.8. And obstructed in building, you can see that it is increasing and you have to consider it to be up to 4 to 6. So it is depending upon the environment, okay, that we are trying to consider. Depending upon that, we will try to consider this path loss component. These are few examples, okay, that we are going to consider. But for time being, these things probably will try to come back in the second chapter. But in this chapter, let us try to understand that if I'm trying to transmit with a power PT from this transmitting antenna, by the time it reaches your receiver, receiver power is inversely proportional to R power N, where R is the distance. Okay, with this single point, rest of the things will be derived. So you can forget rest of the things. Just remember one single point that, okay, if PT is the power with which I am transmitting, received power at a distance R, okay, is what PR is inversely proportional to R power N. N, depending upon the context, we'll try to consider. So this mathematical thing, we will try to use in deriving some of the concepts. Okay, so keeping this in the mind, let us move ahead. Okay, we'll try to come back and we'll try to derive that signal to interference ratio probably once we discuss about this interference portion. Okay, as I said, interference, we have two types of interference. One is adjacent channel interference and then co-channel interference. As the name itself indicates, adjacent channel. What do you mean by adjacent channel interference? Okay, I hope you have solved one particular problem where the number of channels we have considered in a particular cell. Okay, I hope when we have considered Airtel service provider having 42 service channels or what 42 channel that they are having it. Okay, so 7 is the cluster size that we are using, and we have assumed that each cell is having 6 channels. Each cell is having 6 channels, and F1 to F6 we said is being given to A, and F7 to F12 is being given to B. Now in this, the adjacent channel interference is F1 to F6 when I am considering. F1, F2, F3, these are adjacent channels. Now these adjacent channels, okay, if I am not doing a proper filtering, okay, because see, when I am looking at that particular channels, you have sharp cutoffs. But okay, that is an ideal filter that I have to design. As ideal filters are not possible, in case of practical things, you will see that you will not have that sharp cutoffs, but you will have a roll off. So because of that improper filtering, a portion of the adjacent channel comes and gets interfered with the current channel. That is what we call it as adjacent channel interference. Okay, so it, another name for this is inter-channel interference. This is because of extra power from the signal in an adjacent channel. Okay, this we will try to see it pictorially so that you will understand it quite clearly. And as I said, it is because of the improper filtering, you'll get this adjacent channel interference. Okay, other type is co-channel interference, and this I hope everybody understands. Co-channel is because where we are trying to use same set of channels or same set of frequencies. The moment when two persons are sending the information on the same carrier, definitely there will be interference, and that particular interference we call it as co-channel interference. And why the two persons are sending on the same frequency? Because of the concept of frequency reuse that we have seen it. We are trying to reuse at a nearby distance. Because of that, what is happening, it is same set of frequencies are being allocated to two users. Hence, there will be a chance of interference, and such a kind of interference we call it as co-channel interference. Okay, so besides the intended signal from the cell, signal at the same frequency arrive at the receiver from undesired transmitters in other cells. As I said, you have a wanted signal in this particular cell. You have your wanted signal, And from the co-channel cell, which is what unwanted, that is coming and getting interfered with the current user. Hence, such a kind of thing we call it as co-channel interference. As we said, this is due to frequency reuse. These two things, we'll try to look at it pictorially so that things would become quite clear. First, let us look at the adjacent channel interference. Okay. So in adjacent channel interference, we said for a particular cell, the channels that are being allocated was F1 to F6. Let us consider the first cell, F1 to F6. Okay. So let me take, these are the channels that I have. Okay. F1, F2, F3. These are the channel that we have. Okay. Now you can see that if this is the channel, this is the center frequency of the channel, and you are trying to put your information on top of this. You are trying to put your information on top of this. So at the receiver end, what you are trying to do is you are trying to put up a filter, okay, which is tuning to this particular frequency, and you are trying to get back this information. Okay. So that is the basic concept that we have it. Now in this case, what is happening? It is, suppose at the receiver, if you are trying to design a particular filter, so your filter should have these ideal characteristics. In case of ideal thing, okay, but you know that, okay, this ideal things, okay, ideal filter, realization of this ideal filter is not possible. Hence, we'll try to go for a practical filter. You will not have the sharp cutoff for this practical. Rather than that, you'll have some roll off like this. So this is the practical filter that, okay, one can go for it. Now, because of this, what is happening is you can see that this is the practical filter that I have. Now, a portion of that is getting spilled over onto the adjacent channel. These two I'm calling it as adjacent channels. Okay. Now, same is the case with this filter also. So if I'm trying to look at it, okay, you can see that this is the response. And probably for this filter, these are practical filters that what I'm trying to implement. Now you can see here that a portion, okay, this is the channel. And this is the adjacent channel. Adjacent channel is coming and getting interfered with this. Hence, this is what we call it as adjacent channel interference. So hence, I'm putting it as, this is what adjacent, because of the adjacent channel interference. And this is also because of the adjacent channel interference. Okay. Because of these interferences, okay, adjacent as well as co-channel interference, you'll get sometimes a crosstalk. Okay. So basically this adjacent channel interference is because of what? Because of this inadequate or improper filtering. Okay. For that, what one can do is one can, okay, place these two things apart. Means in between, I can place some guard band, which is what generally we call it as guard band, which, okay, which is being given just to avoid such a kind of things. But again, you can see that the moment when I'm giving this guard band, so you are not utilizing that particular frequency spectrum. So for a proper utilization, you should use that particular spectrum also. Okay. So, but if I'm using it, then I have a concept of interference. Okay. This is what adjacent channel interference. Okay. And we'll not deal much with this adjacent channel interference, but we'll try to go for this co-channel interference, and we'll try to derive a mathematical expression for signal to interference ratio. Okay. As we said, co-channel interference. Okay, let us try to understand from this picture. Okay, it would be, I hope it would be very clear. Co-channel is basically, say this is the cell that I'm trying to consider. Okay, and a co-channel is, I'm trying to reuse the same set of frequencies somewhere at a distance D. That's what we have seen. Okay. And now I'm trying to deploy a base station here. Okay. Now suppose if I have a mobile handset here. Okay, now I have a mobile handset here. This is trying to receive. Okay. Now what is going to happen? It is this and this are using same set of frequencies. That is the reason why we call these two as co-channel cells. And you can see that you have signal that is receiving from this particular base station. That is wanted signal. And at the same time, if the same frequency is being allocated here and which is radiating from this, so a portion of that comes and gets interfered with this, which is what I'm calling it as unwanted signal. This is not required for me. But because of this multipole propagation and all, this comes and gets interfered with this. And that is what you call it as interference. And that is what you call it as co-channel interference, because same set of frequencies, that is what is being used. Okay. To put it okay, pictorially. Let's assume that the radius of these things is okay r. This is the actual signal, putting okay that in green color, actual signal power, okay, which is what is required from this particular base station. Apart from that, what I have, a portion of that okay comes from here, and this I am trying to paint it as red color, which is what unwanted, we call that as interference. Okay, signal, and this is interference. Okay, now what I want at the mobile handset is we are trying to maintain signal to interference ratio. Okay, we wanted to have more signal power than the interference so that we will be able to detect that particular signal. Okay, like the way that we have we'll do it in signal to noise ratio. Signal to noise ratio we'll try to maintain, because noise is something you cannot avoid it. Hence, what you'll try to do is we'll try to keep your signal levels above that of your noise levels. A similar concept that we'll try to use it, signal to interference ratio. Now, okay, this thing, let us use the mathematical derivation that we have already okay derived it in the previous slides. We said PT is the transmission power with which if I am transmitting, received power at this particular location would be what? Inversely proportional to whatever the distance that I have. Is that correct or not? Inversely proportional to distance, r power n. Okay, similarly, what about the interference power? This also, if PT is the power with which it is transmitting, I have to take up this distance. It is inversely proportional to distance power n. Okay, so now the mathematical equations will become quite simple. So I am considering the distance between these two is d. This I hope you have derived it. Co-channel cell distance, capital D. Okay, so what would be the signal power now? S is what? The actual signal power, or in other words, I am saying that received power at this mobile handset. Received power at this mobile handset, and you know that received power is what? Inversely proportional to r power n. Assuming that okay, you have a distance of r, so obviously signal is what? Inversely proportional to r power n. As far as this signal power is concerned, a similar expression I can write for interference power. PT is the transmission power. Okay, it is transmitting. The power is inversely proportional to d power n. And you know that okay, this is smaller, r is smaller, hence the signal power would be more than the interference power. Okay, if I am clubbing these two, okay, s by i, if I am trying to write signal to interference ratio, s by i, so this PT and PT gets cancelled, and what I have it is d by r power n. Signal to interference is equal to what? D by r power n. Okay, now you can see that d by r, this is what we have already derived, frequency reuse factor. Okay, d by r. So, or in other words, you can see that signal power is okay inversely proportional to r, hence interference is also inversely proportional to d. Or in other words, what I can write it is directly, straight away I can write signal power is directly proportional to r power minus n, and interference is directly proportional to d power minus n. So hence signal to interference is, signal is directly proportional to r power minus n, interference is directly proportional to d power minus n. Same expression, but I am putting in terms of minus. Okay, so this is the mathematical expression that I have for signal to interference, and this is what we are going to use it. So co-channel interference is basically what? Interference because of the co-channel cells. How am I doing it basically? Okay, signal that is coming from this base station is what? The actual signal, and whatever it is coming from here is interference power. Okay, signal power is directly proportional to r power minus n, and interference power is directly proportional to d power minus n. Hence signal to interference, we are getting it, is equal to what? D by r whole power n. And whatever that we have assumed so far is, when I am assuming that I have only one interfere, okay, one interferer here, okay, but in the previous case we have seen, okay, when we are using cell splitting and all, you have first tier interferers. There are about 6 first tier interferers, and then 12 second tier, 18 third tier. Okay, now in such a cases, what is the signal to interference ratio? That, okay, just let us see. The expression would be quite simple. If I understood this particular point, rest of the things are quite simple. So all that I have to understand from this is the base station, this is the mobile handset, and the wanted signal for this is S, which has to come from this, and unwanted signal is this. And we have seen the mathematical derivation that signal power is directly proportional to R power minus N, and interference is directly proportional to D power minus N. If I am putting S by I equal to D by R whole power N. Now, so let me extend this. Okay, so now in this, okay, cluster size equal to 3, we said that, okay, for this, these are what your co-channel cells. Is that correct or not? That's what we have seen it. These are what co-channel cells, and when I'm using omnidirectional antennas, obviously, okay, it radiates equally well in all the directions. So if I'm trying to consider a mobile handset over here, so I have how many interferers that I have starting from this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, I'm considering only first tier interferers, or probably if I'm keep on extending it, I may get second tier, more 12, and so on, I'll get it. But I'm neglecting second tier and third tier, assuming the fact that by the time the signal comes from there to here, okay, would be nullified. Okay, keeping that in the mind, let's extend the previous discussion. This is a mobile station, this is the base station I have. Let's assume that I have a mobile handset. So the wanted signal for this is what? This is the wanted signal, signal power, which is directly proportional to R power minus N. Signal power is directly proportional to R power minus N, where R is the distance between this. Okay, and what about the interference power here? I'll get a interference from this point to this point, and I'll get an interference from this point to this one. This I'll name it as I1. This I'll take it as I2, I3, I4, I5, and I6. So now if I'm trying to calculate the signal to interference ratio at this mobile handset, okay, so I have to write it as signal power by interference power, where interference power is equal to what? I have to sum all these things, I1 plus I2 plus I3 plus I4 plus I5 plus I6. That mathematical expression I'm writing here. So signal to interference is equal to what? Signal power by the interference, I'm writing I equal to 1 to M. In this case, M equal to 6. So I1 plus I2, I1 plus I2 plus I3 plus I4, I5 and I6. Okay. Now the assumption that I'm making it is, let us assume that all of them are at same distance. Just a kind of assumption that I'm making it. Need not be practically, but just I'm assuming that all of them are at same distance from this mobile handset. So signal power is directly proportional to R power minus N. So what would be this interference power I1? I1 is directly proportional to D1, where D1 power minus N, D2 power minus N, D3 power minus N, I4 is D4 power minus N. But as I've assumed, all of them are at equal distance. So I am taking D power minus N, all D, D1, D2, D3 and so on equal to D. So mathematical expression would be what? R power minus N. D power, okay, I is from 1 to M, D power minus N. Okay, signal interference ratio equal to 1. Now, how many such components that I have? M components, as I have, okay, taken all of them are equal. So, M into D power minus N. That's what, okay, I am considering. Now, D power minus N. So, slightly modifying this expression, what is that you get? Signal to interference ratio is equal to what? D by R. Okay, this if I'm taking, okay, onto the numerator, you'll get D by R whole power N by M. In this case, M equal to 6. Okay, but more general, I'm assuming that M is what? 6 first tier interferers, and then more 12 second tier, and 18 third tier. Okay, in general, S by I equal to D by R whole power N by M, where D by R is frequency reuse factor. And we have derived already expression D by R equal to what? Square root of 3 into N. So I am substituting in that. So you can find out signal to interference ratio provided if you know the cluster size. Is that correct or not? For a particular cluster size and a path loss component and the number of interferers if you have, you can find out the signal to interference ratio. Okay, this is one thing. Okay, extending the previous discussion to, okay, this particular co-channel interference. Okay. Now, in the previous case, what we have assumed is all of them are at same distance with this particular mobile handset. Hence, I have got it. Now, in the next case, what we'll try to do is we'll try to derive a worst case scenario. Co-channel interference, okay? Worst case. I'm calling it as worst case because I'm assuming that mobile is at cell boundary. So, when mobile is at cell boundary, so you'll get very less signal power. So, signal power would be very less. So, interference power, okay, is also coming into picture. Hence, that would be signal to interference ratio would be very, okay, less. That is the reason why I am naming it as worst case. Okay, a similar derivation, whatever that we have done. Okay, only slight modification that I am making it, assuming the fact that as it is at cell boundary. Okay, so signal power is directly proportional to r power minus n. That directly comes because r is the radius of that particular hexagon. Okay, now for this, these are what your co-channel cells. Okay, now this is the wanted power and this is the unwanted power. Now you can see that this I am taking it to be unwanted power, and you see, okay, I am putting the distance as d minus r, assuming the fact that d is the distance. This is the distance. D is the co-channel cell distance and r is the distance from here to here. So this distance I am taking it to be d minus r. Okay, and this also, as I am putting on this side, so this is also d minus r. And suppose this, if I am trying to consider somewhere here, because this is on the other side, so you will get from here to here d plus this r. So hence you will get d plus r. For this also d plus r, and probably these two I can take it d. Okay, only difference that I have it is I1 and I2 are at a distance d minus r, I3 and I4 are at a distance d, and I5 and I6, they are at a distance of d plus r. So again, the formula would be same. Wanted power is directly proportional to r power minus n, and I1 is directly proportional to d minus r whole power minus n. Okay, how many such components that I have? Two components, and these are also two components, and these are also two components. So overall signal to interference ratio would be what? Signal power is directly proportional to r power minus n. Two of the components with the distance of d minus r whole power minus n. Two of the components distance d, and two of the other components d plus r. So you can see that this is, okay, a worst case scenario derivation for a signal to interference ratio. Okay, and this I am trying to put up, just if I am taking out this, okay, r outside, then you will get d by r. If I am taking r outside and this r power minus n and this gets cancelled in everywhere, if I am trying to take it out, so you will get d by r minus 1. Okay, where d by r, frequency reuse factor, this we have seen it, d by r, I am putting it as q. Okay, then in that case, what the slight modification in the expression that you will get it is d by r is q. So q minus 1, q, q plus 1. Okay, so that means if I am finding out d by r reuse factor, if I know that directly, then I can find out what is my signal to interference ratio. Okay, this is the worst case scenario. Okay, now when I am trying to consider this is signal to interference ratio, so in case of wired communication, we have seen for a particular channel, okay, what is the capacity in wired communication? You might have seen this expression, capacity is equal to what? Bandwidth into log of 1 plus signal to noise ratio, B into log of 1 plus signal to noise. Okay, but in this case, in case of wireless, you have a slight change. Apart from your noise, you have interference, and this interference could be co-channel as well as adjacent channel. So capacity of a channel, okay, capacity, channel capacity in case of wireless is, okay, same mathematical expression that you might have seen for your wired communication. Okay, but there you are not considering interference because signal to noise ratio. Okay, it was a wired communication, there was no interference, but as it is wireless, you'll have a concept of interference. So in the mathematical expression, you have a change, 1 plus signal to noise plus interference, and this interference could be, You can write it as I adjacent plus I cochannel. Okay, so this is the another mathematical derivation that we have for a worst case scenario. Okay, now let's see some problems. Okay, let us try to solve a problem on this particular mathematical expressions that we have seen. First, let us try to understand the problem, and then we'll try to move on. Okay, so if a signal to interference ratio of 15 dB is required, okay, what is being given is signal to interference ratio of 15 dB is required for satisfactory forward channel performance of a cellular system. What is the frequency reuse factor and cluster size that should be used for maximum capacity if the path loss exponent is n equal to 4 or n equal to 3? Assume that there are 6 co-channel cells in the first tier and all of them are at the same distance from the mobile. Okay, in the first case, whatever the derivation that we have done. Okay, so what is being given in the problem is this is the required signal to interference ratio. Okay, that means I have to maintain at least a 15 dB of signal to interference ratio. Okay, then what I have to do it is, what we are trying to say it is, if I have to maintain a minimum of 15 dB signal to interference ratio, what is the cluster size that I have to consider? Okay, what is the frequency reuse factor and cluster size? Because these two can are interrelated, so you can write, once you get the cluster size n, square root of 3n is nothing but what? Frequency reuse factor d by r. D by r equal to square root of 3n, that we have already seen in the previous case. So you can, in other words, what you can do it is, derivation also we have seen, s by I is equal to what? D by r whole power n by m. Okay, where, okay, signal to noise, signal to interference ratio is given. Okay, and if I'm putting square root of 3n whole power n, okay, probably you have to find out cluster size for a particular path loss component, and they have already given that there are 6 co-channel cells in the first tier and all of them are at the same distance. So we have to use the first formula. Okay, so directly one can go for it straight away, usage of formula, signal to interference ratio equal to square root of 3n whole power n by capital N. Okay, so then from that I need to find out my cluster size, but I'll try to do it in a reverse way. Okay, that is a forward method, or you can do this method also, wherein what I'm trying to do is, let me assume one cluster size, okay, and then see what is the signal to interference ratio. Okay, if it is getting satisfied, then we'll try to take up the cluster size, or otherwise we'll try to increase the cluster size. Okay, for example, this is the basic formula that you have. Frequency, it is being asked frequency reuse factor and cluster size. Once I know the cluster size, square root of 3 into n is nothing but frequency reuse factor d by r. Okay, so let us assume for the first path loss component n equal to 4, cluster size equal to 7. Cluster size, let us assume cluster size n equal to 7. When cluster size n equal to 7, so what is the frequency reuse factor? Cluster size I'm assuming equal to 7. So frequency reuse factor equal to what? D by r, which is equal to square root of 3 into n. That is 3 into 7, that is equal to what? Square root of 21. Okay, so the signal to interference ratio would be what? So I assume frequency reuse factor equal to what? D by r, square root of 21. Square root of 21 would be 4.583. And then you can see signal to interference ratio is equal to d by r whole power n by m. These are the things that we have already derived. D by r equal to square root of 3n. Okay, now I am assuming that, okay, cluster size is equal to 7. So square root of 3 into 7, that is 21, that is nothing but 4.58. so 4.583 whole power path loss component n equal to 4. And what is this m value? Because assume that there are 6 co-channel cells in the first tier and all of them are at the same distance. Hence, I am considering this. Divided by 6 is going to give you 75.3. If I am converting it into dB, I am getting 18.66 dB. Okay. Now, what is it we have got it? It is signal to interference. If I am taking a cluster size of 7, I am getting signal to interference ratio as 18.66 66 dB. And what is the question that is being asked? If a signal to interference ratio of 15 dB is required, minimum of 15 dB is required. Okay, so for a cluster size n equal to 7, I am getting minimum equal to what? 18.66. Hence, it is getting satisfied. So, hence, what you can do is you can take this cluster size. So, for this cluster size n equal to 7, and then frequency reuse factor equal to 4.583. Okay, so which is greater than the minimum required. Hence, the cluster size n equal to 7 can be used. Or other method that I was saying is, in this complete expression, you know the signal to interference ratio, m equal to 6, okay, and square root of 3 or d by r, you don't know it. You find out this d by r, n is 4, m is 6, and this. So all these three things are known. All that you have to do is you find out this d by r. Once you get the d by r, square root of, okay, square that divided by 3 is nothing but what here, cluster size. So any other method also, the other way also you can find it. Exactly same thing, I am repeating it for n equal to 3. Okay, let me just take up the same problem. Okay, but I am repeating it for n equal to 3. So again, frequency reuse factor equal to square root of 3n. For n equal to 3, again, now what is happening, it is for path loss component n equal to 3, again I am following the same method. Let us consider cluster size equal to 7. So for cluster size n equal to 7, we have already seen d by r equal to 4.583. Okay, now in this case, let's find out signal to interference ratio. So square root of 3n, square root of 3 into 7, 21, whole power 3. Now this is what is different from the previous case. N equal to 4 previously, now n equal to 3. Because of this, what is I am getting? It is, I am getting 12.05 dB. So when I am considering a cluster size of n equal to 7, the signal to interference ratio is 12. But what is the minimum thing that is required for me? 15. So this is not satisfying this. Since I cannot take n equal to 7 cluster size, go for the next cluster size. Okay, this you will get it. Okay, so go for n equal to, which is less than required, so it cannot be used. So I am going for the next cluster size, that is 12. And as I said previously, all cluster sizes are not possible. You have to take up I and J values properly. I equal to 1, J equal to 2 is giving 7. I equal to 2 and J equal to 2, both 2 gives you 12. So the next would be 12 only. So I am considering 12. So for this, when n equal to 12, what is the frequency reuse factor? Square root of 3 into n. N is 12. 3 into 12, 36. Square root of 36 would be 6. For this again, I am trying to find out from the same formula. S by I, d by r whole power n, square root of 3 into n. 3 into 12, so 6 power 3. So overall, how much I am getting? It is 36. And I am getting 15.56 dB. And you can see that it is greater than this. Okay. Hence, n equal to 12 is satisfied. Hence, the cluster size n equal to 12 we can consider. And for that n equal to 12, the frequency reuse factor is 6. Okay. So this is the another problem. Okay, that we are trying to consider. And so you can solve in any other method also. So ultimately, all that we are trying to look at it here, it is signal to interference ratio depending upon these d by r and m. Probably in some other problems, okay, what things can be changed is, it need not be this particular assumption. Assuming that there are 6 Poisson assumptions in the first layer and all of them are at the same distance. If they are not at the same distance, then you consider the other one, okay, like d1 power minus n plus d2 power minus n and so on. So you have to put those things. If the distances are given, accordingly you have to put, and then accordingly you have to derive it. Or if the worst case scenario is given, then you can consider the second formula, that is d minus r whole power minus n d and then d plus r in case of worst case, assuming that mobile is at cell boundary. So these are the variations in the problem. Okay, the other way also one can ask that. Okay, so the other topic is trunking and the grid of service. Altogether, this would be quite new topic. Yeah, this is already 12 o'clock. So let me stop here today. Probably in the next class, we'll try to take up this trunking and grid of service. some terminology we'll try to look at it, and then we will try to look at two systems, block call cleared and block calls delayed system, and then we'll try to use this particular chat in solving the problems. Okay, now whatever the problem that I'm trying to consider here, it covers almost all the concepts that we have discussed so far. You can see that the number of cells in the service area, number of channels per cell, traffic intensity, maximum carried traffic. Okay, so this gives you a good feeling of what you have studied in this complete chapter. Okay, this let us see it in the probably next class. And apart from that, you have another concept called handoff. Okay, if you are able to cover these two, then most probably we'll try to finish the first chapter. Maybe two classes, we will be able to finish the first chapter. Okay, so just a minute.